Buenas noches. Gracias a todos por asistir a esta conferencia que va a haber hoy con Anibalasma en una serie de tres. Empezó ayer con Julio Yanskis y la mañana continuará con Julián Cortés. Son una serie de conferencias del programa de Compostelas Arquitectura 2012 en el que colaboran relaciones públicas, el Concello de Santiago, de Santiago, el CEGAR y el Colegio de Arquitectos. Bueno, aunque todo el mundo seguro que conoce a Vitani perfectamente, puede simplemente leer una breve introducción sobre su currículum. Vitani es un arquitecto finlandés con oficina en Helsinki desde los años 60. Ha sido además o es profesor en la Universidad de Tecnología de Helsinki. Ha sido director del Museo de Arquitectura Finlandesa, director del Instituto de Diseño de Helsinki. Además, ha sido profesor invitado en varias universidades, entre ellas últimamente la Universidad de Illinois, la Universidad de Washington, la Universidad de Virginia, profesor en la Universidad de Yale, la Universidad de Selassie, en Sarajevo. Y quizás para todos nosotros es más conocido por su labor de crítico, por su labor de escritor, donde ha escrito más de 30 libros y 300 artículos, entre ellos uno de los más conocidos, The Body Image, The Think and Hand, The Architecture of Image, de Isaac Skin. Bueno, con todo este currículum y con todos los libros y la dimensión intelectual de Balasma, más que probada y conocida por todos. Yo en estos días y en el año anterior, que es el segundo año de Compostela, además soy muy conocedor de la dimensión ética de Balasma. Balasma viene aquí para dar una conferencia, en teoría, porque lleva a pasar una semana con nosotros y una semana en relación directa con los alumnos, de uno a uno, hablando con ellos, una labor anónima para la mayor parte de la gente, pero a mí me sorprende cada día que lo veo, ¿no? Su paciencia y su condición humana, algo que trasciende, en mi opinión, incluso su capacidad intelectual. Por todo ello, y por su amistad, gracias a la
I'm actually going to give a lecture which I prepared, finished a year ago, on 100 years of architectural education at Washington University in St. Louis. I hope you don't do my mind, but I'm giving a lecture about it and somewhere else. And I have inquired that the landscapes of architectural education art, knowledge, and existential wisdom. When the poet David Shapiro interviewed John Hayter, the legendary dean of the Cooper Union School of Architecture in New York, and one of the finest and most influential teachers of architecture in the past decades, and asked Hayter about his teaching method. Hayter answered, "I teach osmosistically, by osmosis." With this surprising answer, Hayter reveals the most essential manner of learning, and that is an unconscious, embodied, an existential absorption rather than an intellectual and verbal recording of facts. This immersion is the manner in which each one of us learned our mother tongue, for instance. We never knew is embedded more in the student's sense of self, and his or her image of the world than any information or facts, any education that aims at delivering information on facts is a failed education. The promoters of the world of professionalized education seem to entirely dismiss this essential mental and existential perspective. This area of learning can appropriately be called personal growth. Education and learning in any creative field has to aim at the student's individual and unique self, and not the content of education. The content of education is bound to be more existential than factual, related more with experiences than values than information. I can already hear some objections in the audience. Here there are some professionals in the audience. But I'll continue to explain why I feel this way after having myself taught around the world for 50 years. John Hayden articulates his educational method further when he writes, "I never draw for the student or draw over their work, and I never tell them what to do. I try, in fact, to draw them out." In other words, draw out what's inside them and just hit a certain key point whereby they can develop their idea. End of the report. By the way, he was one of my closest friends. I share with John's educational philosophy, and I have even used the same word of osmosis to describe my own teaching approach based on an unconscious embodied absorption as the central learning process. In meaningful education, we shape and mold ourselves, our very personality, character and self, instead of primarily accumulating facts or even skills. That's another point where standard education goes 100% wrong. This bonding of self takes place predominantly through an unconscious embodied osmosis, or to use the Aristotelian notion, mimesis. Our mimetic skills have recently been valorized by the invention of the mirror neurons. These specialized neural ingredients make us unknowingly mimic movements, gestures, and behaviors and others in our environment. Even newly born babies mimic facial gestures 1 hour after their birth. They mirror and mimic. And the entire magic of architecture and
part, I think, relies on this, our unconscious capacity to mimic through mirror neurons. Through embodied simulation, we unconsciously mimic even physical events, objects, and qualities. I can personally say sincerely that I learned more from the way my professors walked and occupied space with their bodies than from what they spoke. I learned more. Being with my mentors and breathing the same air than doing what they told me to do. We seem to be especially strongly influenced by the ethical air that we breathe in our youth. I think that's the primary task of architectural education, is to exude that ethical air. The essence of learning is the gradual construction of an inner sense of goal, responsibility, ethical stance, and a combined sense of humility and pride. In my view, exactly this polar attitude of humility and pride is the most difficult point to learn. And that's, as far as I'm concerned, the purpose of my teaching. Paradoxically, the essence of learning is unlearning or forgetting the learned facts. I once had the opportunity of carrying a dinner conversation with the great Spanish sculptor Eduardo Chillida. During the evening, he said to me, in my work, I have never had any use for what I have done before. This is a stunning confession of vulnerability from one of the finest artists of last century. Mind you, this guy was also a thinker of the caliber that he collaborated in a book with Martin Heidegger. Gustav Bachelard, another seminal philosopher, also uses exactly the notion unlearning in his stunning and humbling advice on what it takes to write, in his stunning and humbling advice on what it takes to write a single line of verse. Rainer Maria Rilke first said that verses arise from experiences, but these experiences have to be forgotten. And still, it is not yet enough to have memories. One must be able to forget them when they are many, and one must have great patience to wait until they come again. For it is not yet the memories themselves, not till they have turned to blood within us, to glance and gesture, nameless and no longer to be distinguished from ourselves. Not till then a most rare hour, the first word of a verse may arise in the midst and goes forth from them. I do not know any more magnificent description of what creative moment is, and a better advice for students. This is by Maria Hilke, the poet. Why should the making of architecture differ fundamentally from writing a verse? In my mind, no. Simply, we humans are complete biological beings, and in any creative work, we react with our entire existential sense and identity, rather than with our isolated intellect. And we think with our bodies and intestines as much as with our brain cells. Wisdom arises from existential experiences, not mere pieces of information. The hierarchical scale, information, knowledge, wisdom, is not always understood in pedagogical practices. Ludwig Wittgenstein suggests, quote, work on philosophy, like work in architecture in many respects, is really work on oneself, on one's own conception, on how one sees things and what one expects of them. We have to make ourselves and construct our world before we are capable of building places for other people to dwell or contemplate in. The making of an architect starts from the making of self. In educating creative capacities, information has to turn into knowledge, knowledge into existential understanding, and understanding into internalized wisdom. And what is wisdom? Isn't wisdom the finest and deepest quality of being human? As T.S. Eliot, one of the great men of St. Louis, writes, where is the life we lost in him? Where is the wisdom we lost in knowledge? Where is the knowledge we have lost in information? All the computer freaks, which have this kind of thoughts. The poet's lines make we think of the most severe threat to humanistic and creative education today, the loss of the book. Books. Whether books on poetry, novels, arts, or the sciences, develop fundamental narratives of causality, and they open up epic views into the continuum of culture and human life. Regardless of the numerous advantages, digital media break narratives. They break possession, and they break logic into fragmented bits of information. They also strip away inherent human meaning, intimacy, tactility and sensuality of things. It is not information in a book that is of primary value. It is the book itself. The logic of the story and its ethic, causality, that possesses the highest educational value. That cannot be projected on anywhere else but the book itself as an object. Great novels provide the most profound theater of learning about the logic or illogic, the ecstasies and frustrations of life. Literature permits us to view and experience life and its mysteries and dramas through the minds and hearts of some of the finest and most talented individuals of the human kind. Through art, we can see with the eyes of Piero della Francesca or Vermeer. We can feel with the heart of Rilke and Eliot. This is the great gift, the great mercy of profound art and poetry. Great architects lend us the sensitivity of their skin to feel, quote, how the world touches us, unquote. This is a quotation of Maurice Merleau-Ponty, how the world touches us. For me, that's the definition of art. To use a beautiful notion of Maurice Merleau-Ponty, we can feel the touch of the world and culture through the skin of Luis Barragán or Luis Prandt, and experience the mysteries as well as truths of existence. The complexity of the phenomenon of architecture results from its impurity, impure conceptual essence as a field of human endeavor. Architecture is a practical and metaphysical act. It is a utilitarian and poetic, technological and artistic, economic and existential, collective and individual, manifestation, all at the same time. I cannot think of a more complex human endeavor or discipline which would have a more complex and essentially more conflicting grounding in the lived reality and human intentionality. We are facing a really impossible task, I would say. Architecture is a response to existing demands, fears, wishes, and desires, at the same time that it creates its own reality and criteria. It unites the past, present, and future. It is both the end and the means. That's the most absurd aspect of architecture, is that it is at the same time the end and the means. How do you deal with such a phenomenon? Besides, it is aspiration towards an ideal. Authentic architecture always surpasses all consciously set aims, and consequently, architecture is always a gift. How does one possibly teach such an impossible entanglement of requirements and contradictions? The sheer complexity of any architectural task class calls for an embodied manner of wellness and a total introjection. I'm here using a psychoanalytical notion. Introjection is internalizing the world through the mouth, which that is the way our children after birth, they understand the world through the mouth. And in psychoanalytic terminology, that's called introjection. As architects, we have to introject the world. In creative work, the artist and the architect alike are directly engaged with their bodies and existential experiences, rather than focusing on an external and objectified problem. The whole idea that architecture is problem solving is nonsense. There is no problem in architecture. The problem is in human existence. A great musician plays himself rather than an instrument. And a masterful soccer player plays the entity of himself, the other players, and the internalized and embodied team instead of merely kicking the ball. Quote, the player understands where the ball is in a way which is lived rather than known. The mind does not inhabit the playing field, but the field is inhabited by a knowing body. Unquote. Richard Lund writes when he comments on Merleau-Ponty's views on the skill of playing soccer. It's surprising that this French philosopher has comments on soccer play. The wise architect works, I believe, through his or her entire personality, instead of manipulating pieces of pre-existing knowledge or verbal rationalization. An architectural or artistic task is encountered rather than dissolved. In fact, in genuine creative work, knowledge and prior experience has been forgotten. Joseph Brodsky, the Nobel poet, I would suggest to each one of you read Joseph Brodsky's collected essays in two thick volumes. First one entitled Less Than One, and the second one entitled On Grief and Reason. He puts it bluntly, quote, in reality, in art, and I would think science, experience and the accompanying expertise are the maker's first enemies. Aren't we taught to become experts in our fields? Here, one of the greatest poets says, that's the worst enemy you can have, is expertise. And I would say, exactly, yes, the poet is right. Note that here the word experience has a different meaning than in the quote that I gave of Reed a bit earlier. In creative work, forgetting is as important as remembering. Unknowing as important as knowing. Hazy perceptions as valuable as focused seeing. This is implicit in the aphorism of Goethe, which I showed from the beginning of my lecture. I want to say already at this point that because of the impossible task to integrate irreconcilable opposites. The essence of architecture is bound to be mediation and reconciliation rather than expression, not to speak of self-expression. Architecture negotiates between different categories and oppositions. I also wish to argue that architecture is conceivable in its contradictory task only through understanding it as a poetic manifestation. Poetic imagery is capable of overcoming contradictions of logic through its polyvalent, synthetic, unconscious imagery. As Alvarado once wrote, in every case of creative work, one must achieve the simultaneous solution of opposites. Nearly every design task involves tens, often hundreds, sometimes thousands of different contradictory elements, which are forced into a functional harmony only by a man's will. This harmony cannot be achieved by any other means than those of art. For me, this Aldo's pronouncement is a very profound. We can deal with architecture only as a poetic exercise, as an artistic exercise. This, we could speak of a poetic rationality and logic, or a poetic chemistry, to use a notion of Pascal, the French philosopher, poetic chemistry. It's a poetic chemistry that takes place in that every moment of creative understanding. In the past years, I have written quite a lot about the architecture of painting and cinema, and I have also studied how architectural settings and situations are conveyed in poetry and fiction. Marion Chandler's fine book titled Dwelling in Text is a fine study of architectural imagery in American fiction. She explores, as she explains herself, quote, the ways in which writers have appropriated houses as structural, psychological, metaphysical and literary metaphors, constructing complex analogies between house and psyche, house and family structure, house and social environment, house and text. American writers have generally portrayed the structures an individual inhabits as bearing a direct relationship or resemblance to the structure of his or her psyche and inner life, and as constituting a concrete manifestation of specific values. This is a writer about literature. How often are these things talking to you in architecture speak about the secret life of buildings? Considerable amount has also been written on the architectural lessons of music and vice versa, not to speak of direct cross inspirations between these two parts. The Pythagorean harmonics, in fact, is the oldest Western scientific tradition, and it seeks to unite the spiritual essence of music and architecture. I must confess, that I was converted to Pythagoreanism by my professor and mentor, Aris Brewster, already in the early 1960s. I'm still a Pythagorean. Whenever I choose a proportional dimension, I refer to Pythagoras. I will not say more about music in this lecture, but I just suggest that it is an essential parallel to the world of art architecture. All art forms explore the existential essence of culture, life, and human consciousness. This image here, by the way, of course, the left hand side image is, explains the Pythagorean idea of sound turned into visual proportions. The other image is by my mentor, a kind of a secret code. I always use this figure and implicit dimensions in all my work. All art forms explore the existential essence of culture, life, and human consciousness, and all of them are bound to follow similar strategies and aspirations, structures, and metaphors. All arts aspire to present the human condition and the fundamental existential enigma. All art works, from the earliest scale paintings until the latest works today, say the same thing. This is how it feels to be a human being. That's what art says. It's an eternal tautology. This is how it feels to be a human being. Besides, all artistic expression is sieved through the human senses, memory, and imagination. Quote, all painters and poets are born phenomenologists, unquote, as the Dutch phenomenologist Van den Berg writes. So, going back, this is exactly what This is the dimensional system I'm using all my work, which relates visual harmony with musical harmonies. This is a study by my mentor, Professor Rutzman. Yes, all painters and poets are born phenomenologists. And we can say the same of all other artists as well, as von Markowitz, Zenitsky, the neurologist, one of the leading neurologists today, has made another interesting proposition. Artists are, in some sense, neurologists, studying the brain with techniques that are unique to them, but studying unknowingly the brain and its organization nevertheless. This is a rather surprising suggestion by human scientists that artists would be pioneers in neurological studies. I understand perfectly what they say. This view opens up a bottomless well for architectural inspiration and insight through the study of other art forms. Because of its severe logistical complexities and layers of practical requirements, architecture tends to lose sight of its fundamental existential meaning and to turn into pure rationality or mere aesthetics. An encounter with other art forms certainly reinforces the architect's sensitivity all the artistic essence of this order, all art form. This is a book that I recommend to Zemir Tseki, a neurologist. Speaking of the evolution of modern architecture, Alvarado said, quote, "But it all began in painting." In 1947, he wrote, "Abstract forms of art have brought impulses to the architecture of our time, although indirectly, but this fact cannot be denied. On the other hand, architecture has provided sources for abstract art. These two art forms have alternatingly influenced each other." There we are. The arts do have a common root, even in art. That's what I believe. Next. Painting is close to the realm of art, particularly because architectural issues are so often, or I should say, unavoidably, part of the subject matter of painting. Regardless of whether we are looking at representational or abstract art. In fact, this categorization is bound to be, this categorization is highly questionable altogether, as all meaningful art is bound to be representational in the fundamental existential sense. If a work of art does not evoke an existential encounter, meaning it doesn't represent human existence, existential experience in any way, it simply remains meaningless. Late medieval and early Renaissance paintings are particularly inspiring for architects because of the constant presence of architecture. I cannot think of more inspiring and illuminating lessons in architecture than early Renaissance paintings. I look at them every week. If I could one day design a building with the tenderness of Giotto's Fra Angelico's or Piero della Francesca's houses, I would have reached the very purpose of my life. The painter's interest in architecture seems to be related with the process of the differentiation of the world and the individual consciousness. The birth of the first personal architecture deals with discovery of the art myself. In these paintings, buildings are presented almost as human figures. The smallest of details suffices to create the experience of architectural space. A frame opening or a mere edge of a wall provides an architectural setting. The innocence and humanity of this painter in architecture, the equality of the human and architectural figure, is most comforting, touching, and inspiring. This is a truly therapeutic. The best lessons in domesticity and the essence of home are the 17th century Dutch paintings in which house interiors reflect the happy bourgeois lifestyle. The interaction between modern art and modern architecture are well known and acknowledged. But I have not yet seen an architecture which has been inspired by the painterly world of Turner, Claude Monet, or Mark Crawford, for instance. These inviting and enveloping spaces of color project a radiant vision of space, whereas Pierre Bonnard's paintings of bathing women express a delicate sensuality and artisticity which can surely teach a lesson to architects. I look at these paintings by Bonnard at least every second week, because I think they are so fantastic, you know, how space becomes an embodied experience. I want to argue that painting and other art forms have surveyed dimensions of human emotion and spirit, untouched by architects, whose art tends to respond to rationalized normality and remain one-dimensional in its existential scope. The work of numerous artists of our time is closely related with essential issues of architecture, such as Robert Spitzer, Gordon Butler Clark, Michael Heiser, Walter de Maria, Norman Jarre, Robert Irving, Yanis Kounelis, Wolfgang Leib, Anne Hamilton, James Terrell, and James Carpenter, just to mention a few of the most obvious cases. These are all artists whose work have inspired architects and will continue to do so. A number of notable architects of our time have explicitly acknowledged the importance of the cinematic world in their work, such as Jean Bell, Bernard Chou, Frank Bolas, and Marie Rocher. This is what Jean Bell has to say about the interaction of architecture and cinema. Oh. Architecture exists, like cinema, in the dimension of time and movement. One receives and reads a building in terms of sequences. To erect a building is to predict and see effect of contrasts and linkage through which one passes in the continuous sharp sequence that a building is. The architect works with cuts and edits framing and opening. Well, I'm quoting John over here for the reason of just pointing out that there is a really close similarity between a logic of architectural thought and cinema. In its inherent abstractness, music has historically been regarded as the art form which is closest to music. Closest to architecture. In my view, however, cinema is even closer to architecture than music. Not solely because of its temporal and spatial structure, but fundamentally because both architecture and cinema articulate lived space. These two arts create and mediate comprehensive images of life. In the same way that buildings and cities create and preserve images of culture and particular ways of life, cinema projects the cultural archaeology of both the time of its making and the era that it depicts. Both forms of art define dimensions and essences of existential space. They both create experiential scenes for life situations. Film directors create pure poetic architecture, which arises directly from our shared mental images of dwelling and domesticity, as well as the eroticism and anxiety of space. Directors like Tarkovsky and Michelangelo Antonioni have created a moving architecture of memory, longing and melody, which assures us that also the art form of architecture is capable of addressing the entire human emotional range, ranging from grief to ecstasy. Jean Vigo's La Talante, Jean Renoir's The Rules of the Game, Orson Welles, Citizen Kane, and many, many other classics of cinema should be made compulsory ingredients of architectural education. Literary lessons in architecture. I turn back to books. As a young man, an aspiring architect, I organize my books in two categories, architecture books and other books. Later on, I realized that all good books are books about architecture in the essential sense that they depict the interaction of individuals with their settings, life histories, institutions and customs, as well as with other individuals. And this is exactly the life world in which architecture takes place. Every single book is an architecture. I realized that the essence of architecture is not in buildings as physical objects, but in their roles as frames through which the world is seen, and as horizons of experiencing and understanding the human condition. Buildings are mental instruments, not simply aestheticized shelters. The essence of architecture is essentially beyond architecture. It's always beyond architecture. Well, let us assume a wall. What takes place behind the wall? The French poet Jean Parmier asks. But we architects rarely bother to imagine what happens behind the walls we have erected. Yet, imagining life is more important than fantasizing spaces, as my mentor Hans Gunther taught me 50 years ago. Somewhat later, I came to yet another realization. The books which I had categorized as non-architecture seemed to reveal more important aspects of the human significance of architecture than the books written specifically about the art of building and architecture. There is an obvious reason for this. Architecture books tend to be with the subject matter as it flows, formalized and usually conventionalized discipline. Whereas poetry, novels and plays are engaged with the very mental ground from which architecture arises. This observation applies to all arts: painting, sculpture, photography, theater, dance, music, and cinema. They all reveal the essence of artistic aspiration and expression, and they valorize existential condition behind artistic expression. All arts are expressions of the time. timeless human existential enigma, and this gives Egyptian art, for instance, its voice by which it approaches us and has such a powerful impact across the abyss of 4.5 millennia. Tonight, Paul Montaigne, look at a picture of the Egyptian art. It's fantastic that 4.5 millennia disappeared because that's where it speaks directly to you. The best lessons in architecture I have read are the following. Anton Chekhov's correspondence, which achieves the essence of human character as well as the tragic and comic aspects of life in the reader's consciousness. He also teaches the supreme virtue of condensation and simplicity in artistic expression. Rainer Maria Rilke's poetry and his novel, the only novel he ever wrote, The Notebooks of Monte Lawrence Brinkley, as well as his letters, all reveal the nature of poetic sensibility and the osmotic interaction between the outer space of the world and the inner space of the mind. Rilke teaches us the irreplaceable value of solitude and silence as conditions sine qua non for creative work. Joseph Brodsky's essays, in which he analyzes in minute detail the poems of Robert Frost, Anna Akhmatova, and Osip Mandelstam, for instance, exposing the incredible archaeology of poetic imagery. Read one of these essays by Brodsky and you understand what a mine of human emotion and imagery a single poem, piece of poem is, maybe 10 lines. He also teaches us how the tragic, vulgar, and commonplace are ennobled as they become condensed